Hi, my name is Nur Sahrish binti Shazali from class AAP 1484A, and today for my course LDA 253, I will be discussing about Eastern Ancient India. During the late period, Asoka, the third emperor, united most of India and dedicated himself to Buddha. This is where civilization started to happen in the Indus Valley, a culture known as the Harappan culture. According to the philosophy of ancient India, pre-Aryan people used to worship places, spirits, guardians, and power of nature. It includes trees, spirits, water, and the whole source of fertility of the vegetables and also animals. Hinduism was a combination of Hindu and Buddha. Buddha accepted Hindu principles of reincarnation, feelings, teachings of moral codes and conduct. Meanwhile, Buddha had an urge of self-control through meditation that could reach a state of nirvana, all consciousness of identity. The landscape of ancient India is mostly mountains and jungles together, and immense from the great monuments emerged to give significance. For example, monuments were self-evolved and out of apparent ways. Gardens are covered by creepers, clean water lakes, and also water lilies. The most famous architecture known in ancient India would be its stupa. The Great Stupa was originally built in 3rd century BCE by Mauryan Emperor Asoka. It was built to house the remains of the historical Buddha and his associates, invariably found at the sites sacred to Buddhism. Stupas may be made of brick and rubble or encased in masonry. The first stupa that we'll be discussing today would be the Great Stupa of Sanchi. It is one of the oldest stone structures in India and an important monument of Indian architecture. This stupa is located at Sanchi, India. Sanchi is 68 kilometers north of Bhopal, Pradesh. It is unique for offering the visitors a chance to see the decay of Buddhist art and architecture during a period for about 1,500 years. The Great Stupa is shaped like a perfect hemispherical dome. A third of its way up from its base, a raised terrace enclosed by a fence, is meant for a ritual of the monument. The balusters of the ground level fence consist of series of octagonal uprights with lenticular crossbars mortised into them. The Great Stupa symbolises Parinirvana, the final dying, a final release from the cycle of birth and rebirth. The Great Stupa is also a cosmic symbol. This is a recurrence of the symbolism of the dome, whereby earth supports heaven and heaven covers earth. In the middle of the 2nd century BCE, the Great Stupa of Sanchi underwent a complete reconstruction after one-time damage inflicted upon it. The reconstruction consisted of 4 elaborate carved gateways that were then added in the 1st century BCE. The 4 gateways, or toronas, are the finest work of art at Sanchi and are among the finest examples of Buddhist art in India. The gateways were carved into pillars, and their tripos architraves are the episodes in various lives of Buddhism.
Hi, my name is Nurana Adina, and now I will share to you about the Great Stupa Borobudur. Borobudur is a massive Buddhist monument in Central Java, Indonesia. The style of Borobudur was influenced by Indian Gupta and post-Gupta art, and the monument was designated a UNESCO World Heritage Site in 1991. It was constructed under the Shailendra dynasty, and it was buried under volcanic ash for about 1,000 years and overgrown with vegetation until discovered by English lieutenant in 1814. The monument combines the symbolic forms of the stupa, the temple mountain, and the mandala. Each of the monument's 3 main levels represent a stage of the way to the bodhisattva, ideal and alignment, which is symbolizing the spiritual journey. Built with about 2 million cubic feet of grey volcanic stone, Borobudur encloses a small hill and is shaped like a stepped pyramid with 3 major levels. The center, 115 feet above the base, consists of a large individual stupa, and at the lowest level, which is partially hidden, are hundreds of reliefs of earthy desires illustrating Kamadhatu, which means the realm of feelings, and the upper level illustrate Arupadhatu, which means the realm of formlessness of detachment from the physical world. The next thing I will share to you is about Angkor Wat. Angkor Wat is located at northwest Cambodia, and it is the largest structure in the world by land area, 162.6 hectares. So, the temple was built in early 12th century in Yasodharapura, the capital of Mer Empire. So, the temple was built as the state temple for the empire and was converted to Buddhist temple towards the end of 12th century. You need to know that every part of Angkor Wat symbolizes something. The temple is a representation of Ma Meru. The home of God's tower symbolizes the five peak of mountain. The wall and the moat symbolizing the surrounding mountain and the ocean. Angkor Wat is a very unique combination of temple mountain. The temple is west orientation and lines of sight from terrace between the temple that shows specific towers to be at the precise location of the sunrise on solstice. And the Angkor Wat temple main tower aligned to the morning sun of the spring equinox. Last but not least is Angkor Thom. Angkor Thom is also known as Great City, which is also located at Cambodia, the enduring capital city of the Mer Empire. It was established in the late 12th century by King Jayavarman VII. Angkor Thom is in Bayan style, the widespread use of laterite and naga carrying giant figures which accompany each of the tower entrance. The walls are of laterite buttressed by earth, and there are gates at each of the cardinal points. One of them is Victory Gate. Victory Gate is 500 meters north to the east gate, and the Victory Way runs parallel to the east road of Victory Square and the Royal Palace north of the Bayan. Angkor Thom symbolizes Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara, which means the guardian of empire cardinal points. Nagas at Angkor Thom appear to be reference to the myth popular in Angkor of the churning of the sea of milk. The Nagas may also represent the transition from the world of men to the world of gods, the Bayan itself.
As in conclusion for today's video, we can learn that India's civilization and culture spreads in many parts of the world, but stuck firm roots in Southeast Asia, including its architectural forms. Even though it was a long time ago that India's influence on Southeast Asia culture and civilization more or less halted, the impact can still be seen today and felt even more on its customs, culture, and architectural designs.